Now we get to a question that is truly about both of the passages, and usually there's only going to be three or four of these that actually require you to think of the double passage as a double passage. Everything that came before this, we could have just treated it like a single passage and never seen the other passage to get the answer. So these are unique, but most of the double passage is not like this. But when it is, we really want to think in terms of dumb summaries, because I don't want to understand the nuances of these guys' arguments. First of all, it probably doesn't matter. But also, second of all, it's going to be difficult to find because the words are tough. These are old-timey passages, so we're going to have trouble with the vocab and the sentence structure. It's just going to be weird. So we want as surface-level, dumb version of what's going on as we can get. And so this question is set up perfectly for that. So if we look at this, it says, in developing their respective arguments, Beveridge and Brian both express admiration. So we're looking for a positive connotation. Well, from what we read in passage one about for the other questions that were about passage one, we know it's very positive, right? Noble land, feed and clothe the world. Nobler destiny, mighty people, right? We know that this whole thing is positive, so we can kind of put that one aside. It was Brian in passage two that was a little bit more negative, right? They're discussing imperialism. Generally speaking, passage one is very pro-imperialism, and generally speaking, passage two is against it. So we need to find something positive in this passage. So now is where we kind of skim, and we just think in terms of connotation. So let's take a look here. If it is right for the United States to hold the Philippine Islands permanently and imitate European empires and the government of colonies, the Republican Party ought to state its position to defend it, and must respect the subject races to protest against such a policy and to resist the extent of their ability. So, sounds bad. The Filipinos do not need any encouragement from Americans now living. Our whole history has been an encouragement not only to the Filipinos, but to all who are denied a voice in their governments. That sounds pretty positive, and it's talking about our history encouraging them. If the Republicans are prepared to censure all who have used language calculated to make the Filipinos hate foreign domination, let them condemn the speech of Patrick Henry. When he uttered the passionate appeal, give me liberty or give me death, he expressed a sentiment which will still echoes in the hearts of men. So, okay, that seems to be positive on Henry. Let them censure Jefferson. Of all the statements of history, none have used words so offensive to those who would hold their fellows in political bondage. Let them censure Washington. So, Washington. And where'd he go? Jefferson, who declared that the colonists must choose between liberty and slavery. Or if the statute of limitations has run against the sins of Henry and Jefferson and Washington, let them censure Lincoln, whose Gettysburg Address will be quoted in defense of popular government when the present advocates of force and conquest are forgotten. So a lot of positive here. So notice I'm reading, and I'm reading fast, but I'm not trying to understand every little thing. I'm looking for key ideas. I'm looking for repeated ideas, and it seems like he's name-dropping a lot of, you know, historical figures. So let's go to the choices now and say, okay, am I getting somewhere with this? So let's look at these choices. What do they express admiration for? The founding and history of the United States. Well, I would say Washington, Jefferson, Lincoln, Patrick Henry, these guys are definitely part of the founding and history of the United States. And at least passage two seems to say positive things about them. We'll hold off on passage one, but let's look at the other things. The vibrancy and diversity of American culture. No, we're not talking about diversity here. This is the 1800s. They don't care about that stuff. Worldwide history of struggles of independence. Well, no. They do talk about the Filipinos, but notice that whole conversation was about talking about American history as their inspiration. And so that's a little sort of a subtle point. But the other fact is he's only talking about the Filipinos. So to jump from that to worldwide history of struggles for independence is very broad. We're getting one foreign, worldwide struggle for independence that's going on right now in the passage. We're not getting a whole course about it. So we've got to be careful that we don't just take one example of something to turn it into this much bigger thing. It's not there. He's not saying anything about all the big worldwide struggles. The idealism that permeates many aspects of American society. Well, I like idealism. That seems to match. But he's very specific about what he's talking about. This is a good example where A is a much more focused version of D. Why are we idealistic? Because of our founding and our history. So maybe this is kind of true, but I like A better. It seems to match. And so now my task is clear. I need to go back to passage one and see if he also says things about America's history and founding. So I'm looking now with purpose at these long lines, and I'm not reading them all for understanding. I'm reading them all to see, do they talk about this one specific thing, the history and founding of the United States? And there was a little of that in the beginning, but then here, Liberty Bell, His Chosen People, history, heroic, faith in our mission, republic, history of soldiers, carried the flag, blazing deserts, yeah, history divinely logical, tremendous, okay, great, positive. That's all I needed. That is enough for me to confidently pick A. So notice, we did a lot more reading for this question than we would for a lot of the other ones. And so that's why these both passages questions tend to have a little bit more reading than we normally do for the no reading strategy. But I think the key point is we're not reading with detail. We're reading with purpose. We don't need to know details that don't matter for this particular question. If they matter for another question, we'll get to them with the next question. We don't need to understand everything we read. We're looking very generally. We're looking at positives and negatives, just a very dumb summary version of what we're reading. And that is more than enough to confidently answer this question. A lot of skimming, a lot of pluses and minuses, 10 points. And that's what we want, to make these hard ones simpler.